So shall we start? Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. As a student of linguistics who is working mainly on Persian, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce our next invited speaker, Professor Polat Sanvalian, who is going to talk to us today about Persian complex predicates. Professor Polat Sanvalian is a professor of linguistics at Université Sorbonne-Nouvelle in Paris, France. She is also the head of research unit Iranian and Indian Worlds at CNRS, which is the French National Board, French National Center for Scientific Research, and a member of the French National Board for Universities for Linguistics. Professor Sanvalian's research interests include the syntax, morphology, and lexicon of Iranian languages, quantitative approaches to syntax, formal approaches to syntax and morphology, and linguistic typology. And Professor Sanvalian's current research projects include languages, dialects, and isoglosses of the Iran, Caucasus, Anatolia, and Near East area, as well as developing language materials for Iranian languages. Please join me in welcoming Professor Polat Sanvalian.
So let me see. Yeah, do you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. So first of all, I'd like to thank Onur. Yeah, he's there. Thank you very much for inviting me. I wasn't aware of the existence of this conference, and I'm really pleased to be here and to be one of the speakers, keynote speakers of this conference. So I'm going to talk about two very old topics in Persian, in Iranian linguistics, and I'll try to have a new look on these old topics. The work I present today, the study I present today, is really a study work on progress. So these are the first results of a preliminary study, and they need to be continued, to be replicated in order to have better results. As the title says, I'm going to talk about the issue of separability, or rather inseparability, of the Persian complex predicates. We're going to see what kind of animals these are. And also, I'm going to talk about another very old topic in Iranian linguistics, the differential object marking. So anybody who has worked or who knows Persian knows about these two topics. So nothing new here, but as I told you, I'll try to have a kind of new look on these things. So this is the outline of my talk. First, I'm going to talk about and to present briefly what complex predicates are and the issues they involve. Then I'll view the inseparability as a question of word order preferences rather than specificity of complex predicates. Then I'll present some existing claims on the separability of CPR components in Persian. Then the experimental data we have explored with PEGA. And finally, the concluding remarks. Before I continue, I must say also that, as you notice, this is a collaboration with one of my ex-PhD students, Pega Fariri, who is actually postdoctoral fellow at the University of Cologne. And all the experimental and statistical parts are, Pega has done all these parts, so I would love her to be here. I would really to answer your questions on that date, on that topic. I'll do my best, but that's not my specialty, in fact. Okay, so let's begin. As I told you, everybody knows that these are really well-known facts about Persian, nothing new here. Persian has only around 250 simplex verbs, only half of which are currently used by the speech community. So although the morphological lexeme formation process, which outputs verbs from nouns, is available, it's not productive. So like in English, we have things like khab, sleep, the noun, khabidan, to sleep, raqs, dance, raqsidan, to dance, which is a very well-known device to create verbs from nouns, to come, to cum milk, to milk, things like that. But although this is available in Persian, it's not really used. So the verbal lexicon is mainly formed by syntactic combinations, which are formed by a verb, of course, and a preverbal element. So Persian is an SOV language, so for these complex predicates, or whatever we call them, the order is nonverbal element and then the verb. There are different kinds of complex predicates, like formed by a noun and a verb, like in Harf Zadan, literally takhit, adjective and a verb, baz kardan, to open, literally open do, a particle and a verb, bardashtan, but I haven't translated bar, I don't know. It has some prepositional, of course, uses, but in this case, the literal meaning is not present, to take, and or a verb and a prepositional phrase like bekar bordan, to use, literally to work take. So these combinations have been labeled in different ways. Complex predicates, it's probably the most recent labeling for them. In Persian literature, grammatical literature, they refer to them as compound verbs, fe'le murakkab, and also in linguistics as light verb constructions. So all of these labels, I mean, I don't care about labels. I took complex predicates because that was the most recent labeling. Okay, so these constructions raise a few issues. Two of them have been thoroughly explored in theoretical works mainly. So the first one is the question of idiomaticity versus compositionality. I'm just going to introduce it. I'm not going to focus on this issue today. I have dealt with this in my book published in 2012 on Persian complex predicates. It's in French, but there have also been a few papers on that. So main issue, as I told, is the idiomaticity versus the compositionality of these constructions. On one hand, these constructions are idiomatic in the sense that they are lexicalized as any lexical unit. That is, in some cases, the meaning of the CPR is not fully predictable from the meaning of its components. And these combinations are subject to various degrees of lexicalization. You have a few examples here. In the first four examples, we cannot say that there is no relationship between the meaning of the whole and the meaning of the components. The meaning of the whole is not, if you don't know it, you cannot always guess it. So like, for instance, çavu zadan, it's not only to hit somebody with a knife, but to injure the person with the knife. Or das zadan is not you take your hand and you give it to somebody, it's to shake hands. Or ab zadan, it's not just to pour water on something, it's to water it, and things like that. And finally, in the last case, das andochtan, to mock. Here there is no, at least in synchrony, there is no way to guess the meaning of the whole if you don't know it. So like words, the meaning of these constructions is lexicalized. You have to learn them. You have to learn them in order to use them in the same way that you learn like to water in English or to milk in English. But on the other hand, these constructions are highly productive and coin and understand new CPRs on the fly. For instance, if we take this paradigm, telefon zadan, telegraph zadan, visim zadan, email, other constructions, more recent coinings are email zadan and SMS zadan. And probably you know that if the paradigm exists, you can coin new constructions in order to enrich the paradigm and to create new lexical units. So this first issue, as I told you, I'm not going to focus on that. If you have questions, I'll answer. I have a few extra slides for that in the annex, but I'm not going to focus on that. There have been two approaches to account for data. The first one I will call the radical compositional approach. It is very popular in the in the Chomskyan framework, and generally the studies in that framework have claimed that even though these constructions are idiomatic, their meaning, a part of their meaning, can be derived compositionally from the contribution of each part a priori, which is either via their lexical meaning or via the construction they are inserted in. Well, this is not my view. I'm rather sympathetic with the second view, which is that these constructions are rather idiomatically combining expressions in the sense of Nomberg et al. And if there is compositionality, I mean, I accept that there is compositionality, but the compositionality is a posteriori, it's not a priori. Once you know, like, to spill the beans, that the example of Nomberg et al., once you know the meaning of the construction, then you can assign each part a meaning and use this meaning to create and to interpret other construction. So you can never say a priori what will be the contribution of the verb and the nonverbal element, because they depend on each other. So there is compositionality, but it is a special kind of compositionality. So that's my approach, and I see why I'm talking about it, because it's also important in the issue I'm going to deal with today. Well, the second issue, which is going to be the focus of this talk, is the fact that these constructions have been claimed to have a dual nature. What does that mean? That they exhibit both lexical and phrasal or construction properties. The fact that they exhibit some word-like constructions have led some linguists to treat them as words. This is the case of, for instance, Adel Goldberg, who claims that Persian CPRs are words by default. And this constraint can be overridden by other constraints, but a priori these are words. Well, there are a few arguments in order to support the hypothesis of the wordhood of these constructions. I'm not going to take all of them. Two of them have been very important. The first one is that CPRs serve as inputs to further lexeme formation rules. So they feed morphological derivational rules. For instance, if we take the suffix e, which is an abilitative adjective formation suffix in Persian, you can add it, of course, to an infinitive, like khordan, to eat, khordani, which can edible or by extension food. And we note that this suffix occurs also with complex predicates. So dus dashtan, which is a complex predicate, to love or to like, and dus dashtani is lovely. Khat khordan, to be scratched, khat khordani, which is scratchable, or jush khordan, to bind jush khordani. We can do it with almost all complex predicates. So this has been claimed to be a very strong argument in favor of the wordhood of this construction. But that's not my view, but, well, that's not the problem today. The second argument on which I'm going to focus is the issue of the inseparability of the components of the CPR. So the claim is that in several works, studies, the claim is that the nonverbal element and the verb must be adjacent and can only be separated by morphological material, whatever that means. And for instance, verbal affixes, clitics, and auxiliaries. You noticed immediately that auxiliaries are not morphological material, but, well, let's say grammatical stuff in one sense. So these three examples illustrate this possibility. As you notice in the first example, the nominal, noun and the verb harf and zadan are separated by verbal prefixes, negation and aspectual affix. In the second, the separation is done by a clitic, a pronoun, dustash daram, so the clitic goes on the nominal element, preverbal nominal element, and not on the verb, which is, if you claim that this is a word, it's a kind of endoclitic, where I don't buy that story, but anyway, if you think that these things are words, you have to buy the story. And in the last example, the element intervening between the noun and the verb is the future auxiliary, which is a grammaticalized modal verb. So these are a few, these facts are uncontroversial. All people working on complex predicates admit that the nonverbal element and the verb can be separated at least by such material. But the claim is that, okay, this is not important because this is not real syntax. We have affixes, we have eclitic, and we have an auxiliary. But this second group of facts are more controversial. So in these examples, which come from my book in 2012, the nonverbal element and the verb are separated by real syntactic material. So in the first example, the constituent intervening between the noun and the verb is the prepositional argument of the complex predicate. So das zadan, which means to touch, and it's to touch to something literally, and the argument to something is between the nominal element of the predicate and the verb. In the second example, this is even worse in some sense because this is a case of extraction, a case of long distance dependency. The element das, hand, is extracted from the sentence and it doesn't occur in the same clause. So it's higher in the hierarchy. So das goftam be golha nazar. And in the last example, which also shows that the nominal element is really syntactically independent, the nominal element of the predicate becomes the subject in the passive construction. So from all these data, some studies conclude that Persian CPRs are syntactic construction, not lexical constructions or morphological constructions. So from this data, my conclusion was that Persian non-verb CPRs are ordinary verb complement or verb object constructions. There is nothing special to be said about that. So if there is something special to be said about Persian CPRs, it's rather their semantics, the way the idiomaticity is built, not their syntax. So this is contra the majority of body of work in Chomskyan framework, which postulates a special construction for complex predicates. So noticing two facts, the things I just mentioned, and also the fact that in Persian, I mean, I cannot understand what it means to say that in a language which has only 100 words, verbs, what can be this distinction between a lexical word and a light verb? So these are all light verbs in some sense. So for me, the sequence formed by the nonverbal element and the verb is an ordinary verb complement or verb object construction. My second conclusion was that the adjacency of the verb and the nonverbal element is a tendency due to the semantic cohesion of between the two elements rather than a hard or binary syntactic constraint. Again, this is against the main body of work on Persian CPRs, which because of this adjacency, again postulates a special syntactic construction for these constructions. And finally, my conclusion was that the same kind of constructs which are observed with these constructions are also observed with ordinary object-verb constructions in Persian. So these were only hypotheses in my work in 2012. And they were not supported by empirical and experimental data. Well, that was, so for the moment, just remember that the uncontroversial thing is that Persian CPRs can be separated by, the components can be separated by grammatical stuff. Controversial thing is that they cannot be separated by real syntactic material. So the crucial issue now is what's the status of the data. This morning I was attending a talk on Turkish about the bare nouns in Turkish. And the interesting thing was that like Persian bare nouns and CPR constructions, a part of the debate is this is grammatical or not, and people never agree on what is grammatical and what is not. So if we want to have solid and sound conclusions and analysis, first we must be able to control our data and to control variation parameters in our data. So that was our goal with PEGA when we started this study. So it was to use experimental methods to get more robust grammatical judgments, and first to see whether one of these two claims is empirically well-founded. Well, so that's the first part of the thing. The second part, as I said, is to view this question of separability or inseparability as a matter of word order preferences rather than a question related to complex predicates. So I'm going to talk here mainly about Pega Fahiri's PhD dissertation on word order variation in Persian, and as we'll see, her results, her conclusions are also valid per se for complex predicates. So I told you to treat this issue as a word order question. So it has been shown that different functional factors are involved to determine the linear order of constituents where the order is not constrained by grammar. So in all situations where there is a variation, where there is a possibility for variation, different studies on word order have showed that these variations can be accounted for by the interaction between various parameters. And for instance, semantic relatedness and collocational relation are two factors known to favor adjacency, which is also the case for CPR components in Persian. And there are also other factors such as heaviness and animacy that has been shown to intervene in ordering preferences, let alone givenness, newness, and information structure, which is much more complicated to control that these things. So what we're going to do is to adopt a quantitative approach in line with studies on word order variation, and our aim is to provide a better understanding of the issue by identifying the factors that favor the adjacency or the non-adjacency. So the work on Persian word order was done by Pega for her PhD. Well, Persian, as I told you and as you know, has differential object marking done. These examples illustrate this phenomenon, and I'll give more explanation later. Well, in these two examples, as you notice, the differential object marking is realized by a non-clitic Ra, which attaches to the right edge, to the right extreme, to the edge of the direct object. So it has been claimed again in not only in grammars, in many grammars, but also in theoretical linguistics, that the neutral canonical word order in Persian depends on the markedness of the direct object. So if the direct object is marked, it tends to precede the indirect object. While, like in example 1, sorry, I don't know why it's 10, and like in example 1A and in example 1B, the reverse order. So here, the direct object is not remarked and it follows the indirect object. So this is called generally the DOM criterion. If you have a marked object, you put it before the indirect object. If you have a non-marked object, you put it after the indirect object. And this claim has been largely accepted in all literature on Persian syntax. Okay? That's to say how intuition can be tricky. Okay? So in order to continue, I just wanted to make it clear how the determination and marking system works in Persian. So as you may know, there is no overt marking of definiteness in Persian, so ketab, can also can be a bare noun, non-determined, non-quantified, or a definite. Indefiniteness, on the other hand, is formally marked either by the enclitic e, like ketabi, or by the numeral yek, or both of them, yek ketabi. Singular noun carrying no formal determination or quantification can either correspond to a definite NP, as like ketab, or to a bare noun. Well, in the object position, this is not possible. But as a subject, ketab can be either the book or books. And bare nouns are not specified for number and can have a mass reading, or either a generic or kind level or existential reading. Okay, now that we know all this, let's go back to this differential object marking thing. Well, definite direct objects are always marked by ra, like in the first example, man in ketab ra kharidam versus ketab kharidam. So I bought this book versus I bought a book, some books, and or in seta ketab ra kharidam. So this is for direct definite objects. Indefinite objects can also be raw marked, which is quite surprising, but it has been claimed that in this case they are specific. Okay, so I'm not going to talk about that, but let's admit that raw marked indefinite objects are also specific. Okay, like I in ketabi ra kharidam is generally translated by I bought a certain book and not just any book. Okay, so as you may notice, well, here already we have something which is reminiscent of complex predicates. That is, when the object is a bare noun, is a bare object, there is a tendency to form a semantic unit with a verb. And in some cases, ketab kharidan has been glossed, has been translated by book buying, or ketab khandan by book reading, as if these constructions denote a single event, a kind of concept, eventual concept. So the fact that in Persian CPRs the nominal element is adjacent to verb is not that surprising, because it's a kind of bare object too. But this claim need to be verified, of course. So what Pega did in her PhD was to use experimental and corpus-based methods to just first to check the DOM criterion, which turned to be invalid, okay, and to identify what are the parameters which determine what order is preferred to another one. So the first thing is rejecting the DOM criterion. So the relative order of verbal complements, rather than being dichotomous on the basis of raw marking, follows a Klein based on the degree of determination. We're going to see that. And the second thing is that the relative order of verbal complements depends on the interaction of a number of functional factors like degree of determination, length, animacy, rather than syntactic hard constraints. Okay. So if we take the DOM criterion, the picture must be that one, the left. So raw marked D-O-I-O-V, non-raw marked objects on the other extreme, I-O-D-O-V. When you take into account corpus and experimental method, the picture is in fact this one. So on one extreme, of course, raw marked objects. On the other extreme, bare nouns or bare objects. And in between, bare modified objects and indefinites, which is a much more complex picture than the one presented by the DOM criterion. So how these conclusions were established, where the corpus work was based on Bijan Khan corpus. Those who work on Persian know that corpora with 2.6 million tokens. It's manually tagged for part of speech corpora. So a part of the work was done on that corpora. Here's the way Pega proceeded. It's how the samples were chosen, etc., etc. I'm not going to develop this. And so the annotation, for the annotation, there were these three parameters: the relative order, raw marking of the DO, and the bareness of the DO. At first, we did this investigation. So the results were almost exactly the same results. So from all this, the conclusion is that, when you look at data more carefully, the thing that seemed to be a binary constraint, grammatical, ungrammatical, becomes rather a Klein. And you can study different parameters which determine which of the possibilities you are going to choose among different possibilities. So now coming back to Persian CPRs, we'd like to apply these results to them and to see whether these results are also valid for them. So I recall what I said a few minutes ago, that it's uncontroversial that nonverbal elements, that the components of a CPR can be separated by, let's say, grammatical material. But it's controversial that truly syntactic constituents can intervene between them. So this is the thing we want to check, whether this second claim, whether the second thing is really controversial or uncontroversial, or it happens. Well, in order to check that, we took one of the very strong claims, or one of the claims on the separability of Persian CPRs, which is proposed by Karimi Dusta in a work in 1997. So what he says it is that there are three types of preverb. He classifies Persian CPRs into three different classes. So there are CPRs formed by verbal nouns, predicative nouns, which have by themselves an argument structure, and in this case we have really light verb constructions, in that the noun has its argument structure and the verb is only there to support the predication, hence the verb, the expression light verb. So in this case, the real predicative element in the complex predicate is the noun, it's not the verb. Okay, this is the first class. And he claims that in this case, no modification, no separation is possible. So the second class are formed by predicative process nouns, which have also an argument structure, but which are clearly nouns, which are not verbs. While the first class, the verbal nouns, have both properties of nouns and verbs. So in this case, he says that modification and separation is possible. And finally, CPRs formed by non-predicative nouns, which are concrete nouns, and they don't carry an argument structure, things like gush kardan, to ear, do, to listen, are among these kind of predicates. So his claim is that only predicative nouns can be separated from the verb when they are realized as a DP or NP or carry determination. So latme zadan, which is a member of the second class, can be separated, like tagar be bagheman latme zad, or tagar latme badi be bagheman zad. So these examples are from Karimi Dusta. On the other hand, he claims that concrete nouns, being semantically opaque, cannot be realized as DPMPs and must remain adjacent to verb, like Ali be radio gush kard, but not Ali gush khubi be radio kard. So the second example is ungrammatical, which is right. I mean, everybody would agree that the second example is, in fact, ungrammatical. So in order to test this claim, we designed an experiment taking into account the word order, the nominal element and the prepositional argument, and also, so we have this two verb order, indirect object, prepositional complement, nominal element and the verb, and the reverse object. We did it with predicative nouns and with concrete nouns, of course, and we designed So this experiment, which is a 2x3 design, so there are in total 24 items. We manipulated the order, as I told you, adjacent versus shifted by the prepositional argument. And we also manipulated the nature of the nominal element, bare none, indefinite, modified definite. And of course, we added to this the two class of nouns, concrete nouns and abstract predicative nouns. You have some example of these items like razadadan to feed, obdadan to water, rangzadan to color, vaksadan to polish, and naftalinzadan to apply naftalin. So the result, and then, so we have the adjacent order and the shifted order for all of these items. Okay. We had a rating, a Likert scale going from 1 to 7. So 1 is totally unacceptable, and set is totally acceptable. And well, Pega is not here to comment the results, but again, in order to show you the results in a more well, this is more this is clear. Probably. So as you see, well, for the whole, I mean the totality of the examples, whatever the nature of the noun, the shifted order is quite equally accepted when the nominal element is either indefinite or modified. Well, the interesting fact is that for the bare nouns, although the rate of acceptability is lower, it's not bad. I mean, it's around 6, okay? So contrary to what has been claimed, even in complex predicates, concrete bare nouns which form the complex predicate with the verb can be separated from the verb without changing the acceptable, the grammaticality of the sentence. So that's, of course, a preliminary experiment. We also checked for concrete nouns. You see the results are not that different. And so what are these results? Then which all, the important thing is that animacy plays a role. So it's not the fact that the nature of the noun doesn't play a real role, but the animacy of the PP argument plays a role here. So if the PP argument is animate, it tends to be separated from the verb. Okay, so it becomes difficult to put it just adjacent to the verb. Okay, so the analysis of the result, and then I'm going to conclude. So only for nouns, only for bare noun, there is a significant difference in the rates between adjacent and shifted orders, but the effect size is, however, medium, and overall shifted orders are not rated as unacceptable, as I told you. So even for bare nouns, the reversed order is well accepted. For indefinite NPs, both orders are similarly rated as highly acceptable, and concrete nouns display similar rating distributions, showing contra karimidustan that in compositional CPs with concrete nouns, the noun can be separated from the verb in the same manner that predicative nouns do. So our mixed model running experiment includes only bare nouns with order and animacy, and we found a significant interaction between the two factors. That is, in line with the animate before inanimate preference, the Persian CPRs behave in the same way. That is, if the PP argument is animate, you tend to put it before the nominal element of the complex predicate. So these results are not unexpected if we follow Samvelian 2012, who considers that the syntactically the CP has the same construction as an ordinary object verb construction. Again, the fact that the nominal element is adjacent to verb is rather due to the semantic cohesion with the verb rather than to a specific syntactic construction. And of course, our results are in line with previous quantitative studies on word order variations in Persian. So what happens in CPRs is not that different from what happens in ordinary syntactic constructions. The concluding remarks, the results of our experiment show that the issue of separability cannot be reduced to the type of the probable noun involved, and that the probable verbal element can be separated by real syntactic material. And the degree of compositionality, idiomaticity of the CP seems to be a better predictor. The more a CP is compositional in the sense of being an idiomatically combining expression, the more the its components are likely to be separable. In other words, CPs belonging to productive cases of constructions, this refers to my work in 2012, are separable. So in sum, our findings challenge those accounts of CPRs that view the separability of the CPR components in terms of purely syntactic rules and credit those that favor an analysis in terms of tendency, preferences, or functional soft constraints. Thank you for your attention.
Two things struck me. One, of course, the compound verb, the second verbal element, the semantics, sometimes determine what goes on. So kardan is so common, frequently used, that there'll be variation of how people...
It's surprising because the only case where the shifted order is not rated as highly as the adjacent order is with bare nouns, which is expected. We don't claim that bare nouns don't tend to be adjacent to verb. And the result shows it. The thing is that when they are not adjacent, speakers don't reject them. Okay, they have just a lower rate of acceptability, but they don't reject it. So which means that finally, this is not an ungrammaticality thing. Is that a change? Why a change in process?
I don't know. Yeah. I'm just saying that
considering we know what an object verb construction is. I mean, I take all this with lots of, a few years ago, I thought all these things exist. There are objects, there are verbs, there are object verb constructions, things like that. These are all hypothetical, these are all abstract constructions, a posteriori constructions. So supposing there is something which we can call, like that, let's go, I'm not a specialist of prosody or phonology, but a few years ago, we worked a lot with Anil Yalan and Jean-Marie Marandan on these prosody questions of bare objects. And one of the striking facts was that a real object and a verb and the complex predicate behave exactly in the same way from the prosody.
Point of view.
For pulmonologists, yeah. That's
well, but they have the same pronunciation and same structure evidence of.
Yeah. Yeah.
So do you think that is something different between newly coined complex predicates and those that have been used?
Oh, we haven't tested. No. This is really a first pilot experience on well-known constructions. So that's a good parameter to also to take into account, perhaps.
Okay,
yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
They
yeah.
Are far from
yeah.
The,
yeah. No, the experiment was really on well-established constructions, and we also excluded, that's also another thing. We didn't take into account, of course, really known things like Rarorgoda, okay, which are really very tough to be separated. Okay, so these things need to be explored. No? So this is really the result for this few constructions, but things are probably much more complicated than that. Thank you very much.